to go for help right now? This is the question, isn't it? Because we're feeling it. The intensity is suddenly ramped up today. I felt it. A lot of people felt it, actually. And the whole Bay Area went kind of cuckoo today, actually. So as the Holy Spirit has very accurately warned us, it said that starting from June 24th, this month, between June 24th and July 24th, this is when we're going to really start to feel it. And this has been very accurate in my own life, and it seems to be in others' lives as well. Suddenly, very, very suddenly, the weirdness is coming. The awkwardness is coming. The awkwardness is coming. Okay. Very awkward. Very, very awkward. So where do we go for help? I asked what to do tonight. I didn't know what to do. And the Holy Spirit said spontaneity. Longchenpa said spontaneity. The emphasis was on spontaneity. So I just said, okay, then let's tape. I don't know what to say. What can you say when everything is getting very weird and awkward, as we were warned about? Well, first we can say the Holy Spirit certainly knows all about it, right? The grace of God. The warnings have been very accurate. And the Holy Spirit also has given us this feeling all along that we will be helped. We will be helped. Just follow along with the program here. Get familiar. Okay, so that's what we're doing. That's what we're doing. So what are the positives? Well, I'm starting to feel better physically and starting to feel the strength come back after the tremendous workouts of previous days. And golf swing is better, mighty. my ability to turn my body now. I actually was able to like turn it, rotate like almost virtually 360 degrees. I don't know how to say this, but somehow I could really twist the body now, or at least 180 degrees, and then my arms can go all the way back. So they start here and go all the way around 360 degrees. So I was really getting great, you know, twisting and flexibility. So, but what does this have to do with anything? Well, everything has everything to do with everything. It's somehow we have to hit a groove here, and so we just have to trust it. Yeah, it was a weird day today in the Bay Area. Jittery stuff that happened. I'm not even going to say what happened. It's too negative. But now the positives. Tremendous showing by Jem Yang Kyentse Choki Lodro. In fact, it was so astonishing. I don't even need to explain it. It's just. I said, "Are you kidding me?" So there is an unfolding of help for us right now that is starting to get very profound, and more direct. And the ego doesn't like it. That's good. That's great. So we are on the verge of something great, spiritually great. We are on the verge. Those who have hung in there and have continued to prepare are on the verge of something really great, just as the world is on the verge of something really terrible, actually. And again, there are people that are feeling it right now, no question about it. I just couldn't calm down today. It's very unusual. I said, wow, there's agitation in the world. And this is what the Holy Spirit said, that there would be profound agitation, mental agitation, awkwardness, confusion, weirdness. There's just tremendous weirdness going on. where it's like upside down and backwards. Everyone's mind is upside down and backwards, and it's just becoming, a freak out, a weird out. So we are looking to get our groove on right now. And so we can just ask for that, ask for help, for the grace of God, to for us to get our groove on. Time to get our groove on. So that maybe this is a way we can kind of look at it. Time to get our groove on. Find our groove. Time to find our groove. So let us focus on that. Time to find our groove. It is really time to simply find our groove. That's it. So we need the courage then to look and see what our groove is going to be. Open the present. Find out what it is. And then, it's like Christmas. Open up the present and see what the present is. So let us focus on that. We're going to unwrap our package that we have, this gift, and finally see, okay. Okay. And then put it on. It's a piece of clothing, so to speak. Wear it, whatever the gift is, be it, wear it. What's it going to be? Well, let's ask for it right now. Let's just ask that we recognize the gift that we have, our groove, and open it up and then get our groove on. That's very simple. We have to get our groove on now. It's imperative. Whatever it might be, I'm not sure. I don't know what mine is. Have to find out. Airplane. Went to an airport today. Weird, very weird. I tried to see what kind of, how much book a flight, and it was such a weird experience. It was just insane. I can't believe how much everything has changed, and actually how weird it's gotten. And looking at the airport, noticing everything, I realized I simply don't fit into this world at all, the future of this world at all, not in the slightest bit. And then I realized that I don't value this world at all, and I have no pride in this world at all, actually zero, not even an iota of pride in this world. I just realized that. Wow, no pride at all in this world. I don't take pride in it at all. Not nature, not people, not places, not things, not accomplishments. You go over, I don't take any pride in this world at all. And I realize I don't just fit into the plans of this world at all. Not at all. It's just, it's very apparent. I mean, flying is so difficult now. Just trying to book a flight, it is so confusing, and they put so much pressure on you. Even trying to follow a flight, see, it's on time. They put pressure on you to download an app. You can't get any information unless you have this app, and everything. And the people, I just seen the people. I said, the push. Everyone's under this push, and there's no room for the sattvic personality of the calm, poised, gracious, friendly. Taking your time as you walk slowly, greeting people, hello, how are you? This whole culture, a beautiful sattvic culture, it's gone. It's completely gone. So there's no place for me here. There's no place for me here. It's just a madhouse. Silicon Valley is truly a madhouse. But this, you can feel this is a global culture. People from everywhere around the world. The young people are just so caught up in this restlessness and this urgent materialism and restlessness and agitation and go, 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 and everything has to be done, electronically, which I find just stupid. It was so much better in the past. It was so much better. It's ridiculously better. Ridiculous. You walk slowly, you smile, you're chatting, you go to the ticket counter, you like to go somewhere, get a ticket, and you check your bags, and you get on the plane. Nobody's hassling, nobody's pushing, it's just the nice soft music playing, and it's just like, oh, I'm so relaxed, we're going on a relaxing vacation. Now, the security comes over to me and says, what's going on? You've been here a long time. Well, I'm waiting, drop someone off. You got to explain. You feel all nervous standing there. Everybody's hustling and the security everywhere. And it's just the whole vibe is just hellish, actually. The vibe is so hellish in this world now, actually, compared to what it used to be. We used to love this world and take pride in it and feel that this was our home and take time to simply feel it. Nowadays, everybody's just look, 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 look. I gotta take a picture of you. I'm not sure who you are. I'm gonna take a picture of a license plate. I go to this place, there's a super security place. Gotta get a badge today. I'm inside this high security area. I don't want to name the company. One of the super high-profile companies in the world. I had to go inside there, and even the security says told me, "Hey, the security here is just ridiculous. People constantly checking on you." So it's like taking that. When I left, it looks like they were taking a picture of my vehicle and a license plate, and not sure who you are and what. I had to go back in. I didn't have my badge. I had to ask them. They said, "Yeah, go ahead," but then you feel like, "Uh-oh," and it's like, what? What kind of world is this, really? Really, what kind of is this a world where we really can settle into the world? Are we really settled here? It's just bizarre. The whole day, terrible crime near a place we were. SWAT teams, 20 police cars, whole area cordoned off. Massive fire in the East Bay recycling plant. The whole valley was filled with black smoke. And then a fuel tanker truck overturned up in Berkeley, I think, was just burning. It's just like the whole day I'm feeling jittery, 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 jittery. Wow, something's wrong. And it's nuts. So, again, I don't take any pride in this world at all. I really don't. Just the opposite. So this is something. A lot of stuff to work on came up. So you may be finding just internally, a lot of stuff is just arising, and it may be just like, wow. I'm not really as attached to this world as I thought I was. Am I attached to civilization? No, not at all. I think civilization we have is terrible. Flying, the prices of flying and the hassle of flying. It's like I could never go anywhere. I'm stuck. I mean, just the difficulty to move around now is ridiculous. And the danger of driving, and the speed everyone's going is so dangerous, actually. I was really shocked trying to price something. I said, "I'm just trying to fly very close and come back an hour's flight." Are you kidding me? And the baggage and everything, it's become this very intensely unfriendly, uncongenial, unhospitable place. The world has become very inhospitable, very, very inhospitable to us now. This isn't my feeling. It used to be that it felt like the world called out to you, and you had this feeling for it. But now, it doesn't call out anymore. It really doesn't call out anymore. It's a reflection, of course, of our consciousness, our consciousness. So, no pride in the world. Let those who take pride in the world, let them take care of it. Really. This is how I'm looking at it. And the future, I realize I don't fit into the future of this world in the slightest bit. Not in any way. Do I fit into the future of this world? So no pride in the world, don't fit into the world at all. Interesting. So what's the groove? What's your groove? We're saying plenty here. If you say, this is really, astonishing, but I recognized this, I realized it. It says, wow. Yeah, I don't feel any allegiance to this world or at all. Or what's taking place here. I don't feel it. I don't feel it at all. What's taking place in this world doesn't seem to be part of my life or being have any relationship to me whatsoever. The activity and events and everything that's happening in the world doesn't seem to have any relationship with me. None. It's not able to relate to me at all. The world's not able to relate to me. It's the world's fault. It's incapable of relating with me right now, and I know I'm very capable of relating. So it's the world that's gone off in a very much of a tangent into a dark place, very dark place. So this is an interesting groove. What happens when you have no pride in the world at all anymore? It's pretty tough to live when you don't have any pride in the world. I feel like wow. How do I function if I don't feel pride? You got to feel pride in what you do. And if you think the world's your home, you have to have pride in it. Otherwise you just can't summon the intensity, to people try to make this place their home. They summon that intensity in this, while these buildings and civilization. It's just amazing what we've done here, because people really felt like this was their home, and they took immense pride in it. They feel like, wow, I've really got to. But now you look at the world and you just say, whoa, it started out kind of beautiful, but this is how it's going now. It's terrible. It's wretched, which is classic ego trickery. The ego tries to make it seem like it's got lots of potential to start out with, but then it starts pulling you into misery. This is what it does. This is what Jesus says. All the ego's roads lead to misery. But sometimes it seems to start out in a positive way, and you think, oh, this is going to be okay. And before you know it, no. Wow. No, no, no. And so this is what we got. The world seemed to be intriguing, and maybe we can beauty and stuff, but now it's just become this jungle, very, very, wow. This crime was in the place, like the last place you'd ever think, in the heart of Silicon Valley, Uber friendly neighborhood. What? I don't know what, I didn't look into it. I'm not going to look into it. But people were telling me, and traffic jams everywhere. People going into turn lanes, exit lanes, and speeding up and then jamming their way back into the lane. Just super impoliteness is coming. And so all the stuff, this is the world. So the world, played us for a fool, actually, really did. I just don't value the world anymore. I don't see value in it. I don't see what is there to value, actually, here. This is the question. What is there to value? So I was able to see there's nothing, actually. Nothing to value here at all. Now, is this a depressive position? No, I don't feel depressed. I feel good. I feel energized and confident, optimistic. I'm just telling it like it is. The effort to value this world has been a failure. Nothing to value here, actually. And so settling into that realization is a very nice meditation. So I look at it as a super positive outlook, super positive. And we can begin to see there's nothing to value here. That's super positive. Because what is here? Here is time. That's what we call here, is time. Belief in time. The belief in time, there's nothing to value within the belief of time, including this world, including all the bodies in the world, this world, everything. There's nothing to value with time. Time is not something that we can find any value in, actually. None. We'll never find value there. We'll never feel comfortable there. We'll never feel like it's our home. Now, positives, Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro, the action guru, super action guru, Superman, really. It's almost like Superman is on our side here. And I feel that he's very pleased. He's being given love now in the West. I just suddenly realized, hey, you know, we're bringing you to the West. We're proclaiming you here, in the 2016 here in California, and in the West. Isn't this extraordinary? And there was just this feeling like, wow. He's got a Western disciple, you know. How cool is that for him? And maybe more than one. Maybe there may be many coming to him, actually, from the West. This is really exciting. We've seen these gurus come from the East, and they have all these devotees from the West, right? It was very exciting. Let's be honest here. Maharishi Mahesh Yogi came. He was one of the first. Paramahansa Yogananda came. Vivekananda came maybe first. Paramahansa Yogananda. Various swamis came, and Maharishi came to the West, and then there was, you know, Muktananda came, and Krishnamurti came. Oh, you know, the great Krishnamurti came, the great sage Krishnamurti came here in the West. Many devotees. And you know that there are other teachers that are contemporary, you know, they come to the East, they're coming here, they're getting devotees. This is very exciting. I saw this truck which says East-West, and it showed them how they were together. And it must be very exciting for Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro that there are some in the West that are, you know, capable of being his disciples. This is astonishing, isn't it, actually? I mean, I'm sure some in the East are just, you know, say, what are you talking about? But keep in mind, 40 years of A Course in Miracles, that'll get you up to speed. That will get you up to speed. And it has. And most of the East is oblivious to A Course in Miracles, actually. Most of the world's oblivious. You're going to have to look long and hard before you find anything superior to A Course in Miracles. Okay? If ever. Just like I say, the universe could last a trillion years, and you will never have any appearance greater than Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma. Okay? A trillion years this universe could last. There's never going to be a greater appearance than that. Now, we may be more receptive to it, and it may seem greater, but no, the presence of bliss that was there in its pristine purity, absolute pristine purity. So we've been tremendously blessed in this day and age here, actually. But the East, rightfully so, feels like, the Westerners are just kind of way behind because we got too entranced by, modernism and materialism and all that, whereas some of the East did not so much. They're catching up now, coming on like gangbusters. But so to get devotees, disciples from the West, from a white man, from the Western white man, this must be for them just a joy. They must value that. I see they value that tremendously. Keep this in mind. This is just something that they have prayed for a long time, and so to get some mature disciples in the West is it must be just they must just like I said, I've seen them in tears. They're just super super. Joyous about it. And so they must value us a great deal, actually. It's a very, encouraging sign, very encouraging that we can hang with them or hang out at least in their spiritual gym, hang around the spiritual gym. I feel like I'm just sort of hanging around it. I'll get their water, I'll carry their luggage, whatever they need, be a gopher. But at least I'm hanging out, hanging around the spiritual gym where they're, working out. I'm just I can't say too much at all because their workouts are really quite something. But we're in the ballpark. We're inside the ballpark. We're hanging out. I could do a little bit, the one inside did indeed settle it all. One inside did indeed settle all. That's a big league practice right there. That's big time big league. And I'm able to do that. And I've gone through it now and I'm feeling it. And yeah, it's super profound. So the ability to do that sort of practice, to practice at that level, is I'm sure that this is really ringing some bells with the Dharma kings. It resonates with them. It's like, yeah, pumping some iron there. Got some spiritual muscles there. We're trying to muscle up. We're getting too heavy. Shaking, before, like, ah, I can't quite do it. Pick up the barbell, I can't do it. I need to spot me, please. And, but now it's like, okay, boom, get the barbell up there. Lock the arms, lock the arms. It's like, boom. I say, yeah, I got it. I can lift that bar. I can lift that barbell. Or is it a bar? That bar, weight bar, yeah. So it's kind of like a threshold has been passed. We're able to lift it and hold it up there. Now the Tibetans know their business. They know the spiritual. They know their spiritual, the path, the ways, the means, the practice. They know their business. So they have to know that. Lifting that practice up like that and holding on to that practice, they have to say, wow, there's some weight on that bar. I'll tell you that. There's some weight on that bar. That's not just somebody lifting a bar with nothing on it or plastic, empty weights on the end of it. Like, this has got major weight on both sides of the bar, and it's going up and being held up there, and then so they'd say, ah, oh, yeah, okay, you're pumping some iron now, that's great. Don't think that they don't respect it. They know how difficult it is, and how effective it is. So when we're doing effective practices, they're all eyes and ears on us, because they know this is going to get results, and it's results that they're after. They live for results. And so this has to have their attention, and it does. Very much so. Jamyang Kyentse Chogyi Lodro gave me this very powerful sign today that we have his full attention. There's no question about it. What we're doing here absolutely has his attention, full stop in the wow. This practice that we're doing, it's an extremely effective practice. And so he's all about results. He's seeing, you know, this is headed for results here. And that's what he cherishes, the fruit on the tree. They see fruit on the tree. Well, what does the good farmer do? That gets the farmer's attention. So we welcome their attention. We absolutely welcome their attention. It's like aficionado of something, singing aficionado, vocalization aficionado. Well, when somebody sings, sings really well, they hear, their ear hears that, and they say, "Hey, you got something there. Yeah, you got something there. I like that. This has potential. Let's see where this voice can go." This is similar. They're aficionados. So aficionados, they don't miss anything. If you're a real aficionado, you're on top of the situation, whether it be wine, or vocals or whatever. You know the latest stuff. I mean, I used to be a baseball aficionado, and various aficionados of various stuff. And boy, I would know what's going on. I would absolutely stay on top of it. Every single day, I would update myself. So I had all the latest information that happened that day. I was a true aficionado. And I would tell people, exactly. I'd say, "Yeah, such and such, he has average slipped down to 299. He went 0 for 4 last night. He's averaging out 299. He needs to, get it. He has to go like 2 for 4 to get it back up over 300. He's trying to hit 300 for the fourth consecutive year. And now the one who holds the record for hitting 300 most consecutive years is such and such and such. And then such and such is second and third." I knew everything, all the records, where everybody stood on an individual basis every day. I mean, it's like total baseball aficionado. Yeah, it's something. It's interesting to be an aficionado, but it doesn't make you happy. I knew the pitchers, the RAs, the records, who was pitching. I'd study the box scores every morning. Who's today's pitchers? What team is playing who? The pitchers, what their records were. Who was injured, who wasn't in the lineup, how each team was doing, everything about them. Just complete, saturation aficionado. And so it's kind of weird for me. I'm not paying any attention to baseball at all now, because I used to be, absolutely dialed in. But that was earlier years. If you're a spiritual aficionado, you're going to be dialed in like that. You're going to know everything that's going on spiritually in the world. And you're going to know every, up-and-coming disciple. Like if a rookie comes into the league, right? I'd be aware of not so much the minor leagues, but prospects. You might be aware of some prospects. People are more aware of prospects now than before. But right now, a lot of people, they know the farm system really, really well, and all the prospects down in the farm system, how far away they are, what they expect of them, how they're doing. So the spiritual aficionado knows, who the prospects are, who's up and coming prospects. Who can hit the curveball? I used to know who can hit the curve. Who can hit the fastball? But who can hit the curve and who can't hit it? So if you start hitting the curveball, then that gets the attention of the big club. They say, "Wow, he can hit the fastball, but struggling with the curve. But now he can hit the curve too. Oh wow, This, what does this mean? This means success. If you can't hit the curve in the big leagues, you're not going to stick very well. You're not going to stick very well. It's tough to stick. You got to learn to lay off of it. You got to work around it. But if you can hit the off-speed stuff and the curves, wow, you're going to stick. You're going to stick. If you got to hit the fastball, of course, too. But so if you can do that, then the big club says, "Wow, this let's start taking a look at this player, because this looks like this is going to be a player here in the big leagues." They can hit. They can hit. Pitcher, has a hard time getting him out. And so then the big club takes interest. They promote him. They start coaching him. They say, "Okay, here's your hitting coach." A lot of coaches, and they start coaching him up, give the best instruction, because now they become a valuable piece of their franchise. Going to, sell a lot of tickets, sell a lot of merchandise, help the club, the image of the club, bring success. And yeah, they treat it like a valuable asset. So it's so different. The spiritual club, they're looking for assets, they're looking for prospects, and when they find prospects, they're going to bring them along. It's valuable to them, very valuable. They want all the help they can get. They're not like saying, it's not some closed club like, let's just kind of limit it, to a few members here, and we'll control everything, like the Illuminati or something. No. They have a big job. They said, let's all more help the better. Let's get every prospect we can, and let's really coach them up great. And we really need the help. It's like that. Truly, one insight did indeed settle it all. And this is what is so tough for all of us to come to. There's only one insight, this, and it settles it all. If we think there's two or three or more, that it gets complex, 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 we just can't believe it could. One insight could settles it all. One insight settles it all. But it does. One insight settles it all. This is the truth. So when you can get to the point where accepting this is like showing you can hit the change up, it gives the pitchers fits if you can hit the change up. So a lot of milestones in my life I've passed where teachers said, if you can get to this milestone, that means you really are getting close. You really got it. The big club is paying attention to you. So you hit these markers. It's great. It's great. So we've heard, at least I have, many have, growing up, that some people will actually find gurus eventually, and they're very fortunate. When the ones that do are extremely fortunate, meaning that they've done the work. Once you find a guru, you can't lose anymore. You can't get lost anymore. They won't let you get lost. They'll keep you on track and be extremely helpful. On track to what? Well, the single insight. One insight settles it all. And to practice, we say one insight did indeed settle it all for me. Absolutely, that's what happened. As if it has already happened. One insight settles it all. So we hear about this, almost mythical reports of some great disciples finding the guru, or the guru finding them, and it just it brings them along, it's like almost mythical. I just wonder, is it a myth or something? But it's happened now. It's happened now here. So it's not a myth. It's you have to put a lot of work. You have to be extremely determined, because we're really way off track, have gotten off track in the West so severely. It's really laborious to get back in shape, spiritual shape. We're so out of shape in the West. We are so out of shape in that out-of-shapeness is being exported around the world as if this is cool. The entertainment industry is trying to make being out of spiritual shape to be the hip thing in the world now. So it makes it, you know, tough to get in good, great spiritual shape. So to get a guru here in the West, that's a real accomplishment for everyone. I wonder what the other bodhisattvas are saying to Jamyang. He's like, you're getting some Western disciples? Wow. Isn't that extraordinary? It must blow the Tibetans' minds a little bit. Really? They might have been thinking that's never going to happen. But along comes Jesus with A Course in Miracles. And we devour that, and we got some muscles. We got some spiritual muscles. we're in like good spiritual shape. They said, hey, can you run up this mountain? Yeah, let's go. I'll meet you at the top. I'll greet you at the top. And it's like, huh? Really? So this is probably quite something for them, actually. We need to look at it this way. I mean, it may be more for them than it is for us, really. Because it's just like, it means we can do it, right? It means we can do it. And the Dharma can penetrate the deepest darkness. So you might think that the guru's all some haughty, you know, high big wig or something. This is not what I've experienced. They're like more happy to meet us than we are to meet them, actually. They're more happy that we're hanging out with them than we are happy we're hanging out with them. They're more happy they're hanging out with us. This is like, they're just thrilled by it. They're not some kind of blasé, you know, seniors just saying, freshmen, What a bother, you know. No. They don't take it for granted. How could they? This has been so super difficult. It's ridiculous, ridiculously difficult. You can't take that for granted. They don't take it for granted, I'll tell you that. Now, the East is frustrated with the West and the way they approach everything, and they just don't get it, actually. But we here, we do get it. We do get it. It's been very difficult. We're entirely serious about this, and know how to practice in the right way, and do practice in the right way. but their attitudes will certainly brighten up when they see us with Jamyang Kyentse Chogyi Lodrill, because he's has so much respect. If you're hanging out with him, that's an attention getter. He doesn't if you can hang with him, wow. The Tibetans, they got no choice but to respect that. It's probably a shocker for him. A positive shock, really. I mean, they respect results. They respect results. They know Jamyang's all about results. So if you're hanging out with him, it means you're all about results. You're not just fooling around. Nobody's fooling or not fooling around. So people, we're asking ourselves, what do we do now? The world's going awkward. Well, what we're doing is we're focusing on the big time. That's what we're doing. You got a big time this world, actually, or it'll crush you. You've got to big time it. So I keep working on my golf swing, for example. And for me, I don't want to go out in the course until I can big time it, big time the course. What's the point? I've already done the other. So what's the point of just, trying to survive? No, I'm going to big time the course. The swing now is getting really, really strong. That's what the pros do. They big time the courses. They do. You watch it, it's a completely different thing. They just say, okay, course, here we come. And you got a bunker there? Well, guess what? Watch the ball. It's flying over the bunker. You thought you put fairway bunkers there? I'm crushing it right over the top of those bunkers. You thought that you're gonna get me here? No, I'm taking it right through there. They walk on a golf course, the golf course starts trembling. Scares the heck out of the golf course. Golf course is used to beating up all the golfers, really. I mean, I know courses that just beat us up so bad it's ridiculous. We're just destroyed. Well, here comes the pros, and the pros are just kind of, smiling and say, oh, okay. They think they're going to get me here. Yeah, okay, nah, not so fast. Yeah, just crushing it, and of course, got no defense. It's got no defense. That's what the pros do. So they big time it. So we need to big time the situation. I'm absolutely big timing it, and I invite everybody to start big timing it as well. Seriously, you have to big time the world, or else it will crush you. Will absolutely crush you into the most abominable misery, actually. You've got to big time it. Now, those who don't know how to, they might say, oh, help, you're leaving me behind. No, you got to set an example for them. How are you going to do it if there's an example? I've always paid attention to those who've big timed the world, big time whatever. They're like the baseball players, like Willie Mays. He big timed baseball. Totally, totally. The best at it. The very best was Willie Mays. He big timed it in every way. He said, baseball, this is what I can do with you. And I can do anything I want to do here. You know that? If I want to do it, watch this. Big timed it. So I've always had my attention on those who really big time at Tiger Woods, big time golf, absolutely big time golf. It was great to watch. He walk out on that first tee, and he's just smiling and joking and accepting the applause. And he's thinking, there's all the members are here of the country club. They're all here, and they're all kind of like saying, laugh, kind of smirking, saying, "Tiger, we set this course up. We know how tough it is. We played it. We got so many tricks in store for you, man. I'm gonna tell you, this course is brutal. You think you got us? No way." These are the members talking, because the course, they set it up and it destroys them. They try to play it, it just destroys them. And they're kind of, they don't want to say anything, but they're kind of smirking. They say, "We got you. We know we got you." And Tiger knows that. It's exactly what they're all thinking. And he's just laughing. Inside, he's just saying, "Yeah, okay. We'll see what you say after I finish this round of golf." And then he goes out and just destroys the course. 8 under or something, and makes it look like it's like a child's course. And the members just like shaking their head. "I can't believe it. I can't believe it. He what? He hit like a hit an 8 iron 200 yards, and stuck it. He took it high. You can't do that. He went over the trees. He went over the trees 200 yards over the trees with an 8 iron, and stuck it on the green, and knocked it in for eagle." I said, "Are you kidding me? That's not supposed to happen." They kept trying to tiger-proof the courses. "Put trees in here. Put trees. Change it, because he's destroying. He's destroying. Masters is thing is with his first time he played the Masters. I think he went 19 under par. Got destroyed the place. The members just went crazy." He says, "We can't have this happen." I go, "How's that? That's impossible." So he's big time it, and that's great example. So we need to big time the world spiritually. Big time the world. So this is what I'm doing. We're bringing in Longchenpa, Padmasambhava, Jamyang Kenshi Chogyi Lodo. We're big time in the world. Absolutely, we are. And this is the only way to go. Got to do it. We want some Nisargadatta Maharaj. Great. Chew on this. Absolutely. So we're bringing the Dharma kings in, Ramana. We're big time in the world. You have to big time it now. Otherwise, again, the world, the mindset of the world, the arrogance of these materialists is just, is crazy. Yeah, you just have to, at some point, you just got, "Yeah, you are being big time. I am a big timer, and you're being big time." Yeah, that really is happening. This is, I believe, the attitude we may have to take. It's like, hey, guess what? You're not eating me for breakfast. I'm not the sheep, I'm the shepherd. They're coming here to get the sheep, sacrifice the sheep. The sheep, I say, "Hey, guess what? You're so blind, you think all of us are sheep here, but you just grabbed a hold of the shepherd. And that's not going to work out very well for you." Like, what? There's not supposed to be any shepherds here. We got rid of all the shepherds. Say, well, guess what? You're living in a mythical, make-believe dream that you got rid of all the shepherds. You need to wake up out of that ridiculous dream. Otherwise, you're going to keep getting these big surprises here. And get used to being big time. This is what the world's all about. We should embrace and call in the big timers and be big time. You have to big time the ego. You have to, because what else is there? The God is big time. There's only the big time. The ego says, no, there's the big time and there's the little time, and the little time is getting rid of the big time. No, ego, you're not getting rid of the big time at all. It's getting rid of you. We're getting rid of you, ego, the I, the image self. We're getting rid of you. So we're doing a spiritual. We got to start spiritual big time, people. Did you hear that? Holy cow. Now, I don't follow politics at this point. It's been almost a year since I've seen any news story, political news story. I don't follow it at all. Because what's happening in politics is Trump is big timing politics. Okay, but that's politics. We're big timing the ego, spiritually. We're spiritual big timers here. Trump is not that. But there's a corollary in that, he's big time in politics, and boy, does that cause people to go crazy, doesn't it? They just absolutely hate it. See, nobody big times us because the little people, they think they're big time. I mean, the present situation, for instance, in the U.S., they really think they're big timers, and Trump's come along and said, "You guys are just you're not big time at all. I'm big timing you and pushing you around. You can't do anything. You thought you could bully me? Guess what? You can't bully me at all." And this just freaks them out. Just freaks them out. They think the freak, some freak has shown up. Trump's some sort of freak. He's big time on us. Nobody big times us. Well, he's pointing out that they're not really as big time as they thought they were, right? Yeah. So, whatever your politics are, there's a bigger principle here of big timing, and so the world spiritually, they may think they're real big timers, but no, we bring in the real stuff, and they just like, "Who the heck do you think you are?" And I say, "Well, I'm someone that it's helping put it all in perspective of who you really are, as far as right now, or as far as overlooking the now." And so turns the tables, and people may not like that at all. You bring in Jamyang Kenshi Choegi Lodro, you're big time in the world, I'm telling you. The world doesn't pay attention to him, because if they do, they'd realize, they'd be humbled. Bring in Longchenpo, that goes without saying, just can't even talk about it hardly, really. To even call Longchenpo big time is a severe understatement. So, but we can relate a little better to Jamyang Kenshi Choegi Lodro. This is a big time guy. This is a big leaguer. This is an all star. This is a heavyweight. And you bring him in to the car show and say, "Hey, check this car out, folks." People kind of look at their car and say, "Oh, my car doesn't look so powerful compared to this one." And someone might not like that. "My car's the best." Others might say, "Wow, this is kind of cool." And again, I remember when Tiger Woods came in, he big time golf, and people just freaked everybody out. People just didn't know what to say. But some loved it, and some hated it, and some didn't know what to make of it. They just said, "This is going to change golf," and he did. He changed golf forever. Never been the same. Just, It was so extraordinary. So we're bringing in this extraordinary talent now, and we're getting ready to big time the world. And this is what has to happen. And I'm just spontaneously, saying this, and the freak is back. Yeah, right. The freak is back. They'll say, "Well, some kind of freak of nature. What's going on? Freak of nature. Freakishly talented. Freakishly spiritually talented." Well, no, just seeing that one insight did indeed settle it all. The ego thinks, oh, it's so complicated. That's the big lie. That's what we're trapped in. We think it's all so complicated. There's no complexity to it whatsoever. One insight did indeed settle it all. Easy, no complexity. So this is the ego just can't handle this. It says, no, I've worked so hard to make it all confusing and complex, and you got to do so many things and blah, 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 blah. No, one insight did indeed settle it all. Settle it all. How many in the West have a real guru, you know? Really. A heavyweight guru, a super heavyweight. And then the world's, you know, they're not expecting that. Catch them by surprise. So Jam Yang's setting it all up. It's his thing. It's his thing. It's his club. It's his team. I'm just playing on his team. We're just playing on his team. He owns the team. Okay, so it's like a baseball team. He's the owner. So he's you know, says, hey, drafted a player. Says, hey, I want you to play on my team. I think you'd be, you know, help the team be effective. So I said, okay, great. I mean, you're playing on his team. That's very prestigious, to say the least. It's like playing on the Yankees or something, you know? I mean, it's very prestigious. Or the Dodgers, or the Giants, or the Red Sox, or the Cardinals or something. You know, something. It's like playing on a very, very prestigious team. This isn't some little expansion team. I know I left out a lot of teams. Fancy. What about our team? The Reds, the Pirates, you know, Cincinnati's the oldest team, and other prestigious teams around the league. But you know what I'm getting at is when you were drafted, like by the Yankees, that was, you know, that was the highest. That was super prestigious. Play for the Yankees. So we're taught here in the West, we got to be good little drones, you know. You're like, oh, we don't know anything, you know. But you got Jam Yang coming here and saying, hey, I want you on my team. Remember when you're young, you pick teams, If you played sports, your neighborhood or whatever, he says, okay, let's choose teams. And you got the captains, got the two captains and the captains that would pick the teams. And you're like sitting there hoping, oh, I hope I get picked. I hope I get picked. Does anybody think I'm any good? You know, it's terrible, isn't it? I remember, you know, if you're not picked, it's just like, wow. The captain doesn't think I'm any good. I haven't impressed him at all. So if the captain says, hey, comes to you and says, hey, I want you on my team, that makes you feel pretty darn good. Because this captain is extremely experienced. Jamyang Gyentse Chokyiloto is extremely experienced. You know, he knows what he is doing and talking about. And he's not going to pick you for his team unless there's a very good reason to do so. Means you got game. You got serious game to be for him to pick you for his team. Serious game. It's like the Europeans coming over here for basketball. You know, we used to think the Europeans couldn't play basketball and the rest of the world couldn't. But now that you're starting to get some players, you know, from all over the world have been playing in the NBA, and you know, some of them have, you know, serious game. And so, you know, maybe the Easterners are saying, who's this guy? If he was, wow, he's unorthodox, I'll tell you that. You know, the way he throws the ball is like, that's weird. You know, he's got a knuckle curve ball or something. What the heck is that? It's kind of like, huh? It's like, very unorthodox. Very unorthodox. Well, let's see if he has any game or not, you know. Number two always tries harder. And at some point, number two, they're pretty good. That's really, if you take it the challenge in the right way, you know, you just don't give up. You keep pushing. You keep pushing. Wow, I really doesn't seem like I'm ever gonna catch up to the number one. The eldest, so to speak. But you end up getting some game. You know, that's so. This is exciting. This is very exciting right now. Longchenpa paved the way, showed up here in the West. I made a request. I said, you know, whoever wants to help out, I'll accept your help totally. And let's do it. And he's the one that showed up. I said, okay, I'm here to help. So that was very exciting. And then now Jamie and Chokey Lodra showed up, and he says, I want you on my team. Very, very, very exciting. So I'm trying to see just, how, this is profound. This is, big time stuff. These folks are super big time. So the super big timers are showing up here now and saying, yeah, we like what you got. Well, all praise to Jesus Christ for A Course in Miracles and for the Christian background of Mary Baker Eddy and New Thought and all the mystics, the great mystics of Christianity, and all the great pastors and priests and revivalists and preachers, and evangelicals and the apostles and the saints and the martyrs and everybody, all of that totality of Christianity. Is responsible in large part to for my backbone. And then I had to get some polish the skills. The potential is there, but it had to be polished and brought forth, and it could be more precise and more sophisticated about it all. You can see the rookies got game, but they're kind of raw, and they need to really hone their talents properly. And then the East has helped with that, and Jesus helped with that immensely. And so they say, hey, you've had some great coaching along the way. Who's your coach? Well, Jesus Christ. Really? Wow. Yeah, he's done a great job. I say, he certainly has. That's to say the least. I mean, what a great coach Jesus Christ is. That is for sure. But these Tibetans don't miss a thing. They can see, where you're strong and where you're weak. That's their business. They put a really a sharp edge on the knife, don't they? They really hone that knife so it's just really beautifully sharp, and can recognize that one insight did indeed settle it all. These are the ones who are used to seeing it, that Padmasambhava simply appeared here, born out of a lotus, so to speak. No parents at all. How about that for a coach? I remember the Japanese baseball team, the World Baseball Classic, and how watching them play in the championship game, wow, was I impressed. I said, wow, they do everything the right way. They're so fundamentally solid. And the United States team is ridiculous. They're just a bunch of guys trying to hit the ball over the fence. The Japanese know all the subtleties of the game better than we do. They outdid us. And what a shock that was. I mean, for America to think, oh, we're the kings of baseball forever. And here come the Japanese, and they just simply tried harder. They've really, they have actually applied themselves to it, because they're not as strong. They can't hit the ball out of the park. They're not as big and strong, so they have to find ways to score, you know, in other ways. And they're just a joy to watch them play. So we thought nobody can beat the United States in baseball. The thought is just ridiculous. But they did, and I had to take my hat off to them and say, boy, boy, have you been applying yourself in a great way. We didn't realize it at all. It was totally, very much a shock. And so maybe, vice versa, the East may think, oh, we're spiritually, nobody can touch us. Nobody can touch us. We're so far ahead, it's just not possible. And yet, maybe they're going to find out that that's not true. Maybe we've been trying to catch up to them, and maybe they've gotten a little bit lazy. Because if they're lazy at all, guess what? We're gonna catch up with you and pass you. I don't feel any of those, Eastern teachers. Not counting the Dharma kings and their associates and all that, but just, the kind of the run-of-the-mill sages and all that stuff. They're not big-time in me at all. I don't feel big-time by them in the slightest bit. They can quote the Bhagavad Gita and everything, the Upanishads and everything else. And okay, so? Let's hear your practice. So maybe we can, shock them and get them going, because, maybe resting on their laurels too much. It seems like it, actually. Just like the U.S. rested on their laurels in baseball, and they got lazy. They don't do the fundamentals properly at all anymore. It's terrible. I love seeing good fundamentals in baseball. I mean, every cutoff person's where they're supposed to be. Everyone's backing up the right base. Everybody's like machine, clockwork. They know exactly where the ball's hit. They know exactly where to go. They know all the signs. They're so alert to everything. They don't miss anything. Wow, the Japanese are great at baseball. There's a lot to the lot to it, a lot to it, and they know it all. Obviously, they're very in depth. They have in depth knowledge of the subtleties and nuances of the game. No question about it. So, hey, more power to them, more power to them. Maybe that'll help us get back, to a better game, or maybe not. In the U.S., it seems like the baseball is just very ragged in terms of fundamentals. It's not that, it's a game of alertness and spontaneity. You never know what's going to happen. Weird situations continuously arise, and who can handle them? Derek Jeter, for instance, was the best at it, really. He was always on top of the game, and nothing weird or awkward could throw him off. And he made one play in the American League Championship Series, I think it was, against the A's, I think. I mean, he's made some plays in big time situations that are just absolutely amazing. To read the whole situation as it unfolded and anticipate what to do and be exactly in the right place at the right time and execute it perfectly, that is baseball. So that's how you're supposed to play. You're alert. You're aware of the overall situation. You are totally aware of what the situation, what could happen, where am I going to be, and then just stay in the moment. You know, it's all unfolding and people are going crazy and running around, the balls bouncing here and back, throwing from and threw it away. Stay in the moment, see where everybody is on the field, what's happening, boom, this is what I need to do. That's Derek Jeter. And what a ball player he was. That's a baseball player. So spiritually, it's the same sort of thing. You know, you really have to really recognize duality for what it is and see it as it tries to creep up on you. The snake is creeping up on you, and boom, you know what to do to whisk that snake away. The snake of doubt creeping up on you. All sorts of snakes will creep up on you. I could just say, guess what, snakes? We're big time in you now. Okay? You're being big time now. You haven't seen nothing yet. But they won't believe it. You know, the Americans couldn't believe the Japanese would beat them in baseball. And they probably still don't believe it. So, it's just luck. It's luck. No, there's no luck to it at all. You don't luck into something like that. They thoroughly outplayed them. Every facet of the game. So maybe, it's time to start big timing. This spontaneously came up in this video, and we're just looking at it as, I've always been so respectful of everybody spiritually, so respectful, bowing to everyone, and just, so much more than me. I'm nothing. You're just so great. Who am I, to say that I know anything? But hey. Sometimes the underdog is no longer the underdog. They toughen up. It's like the kid that keeps getting beat up at school continuously. I felt I've been getting spiritually beat up my whole life. And so they decided to do something about it. Get a trainer, get a trainer and start training with them. And one day the bullies come along and, they start in their old habits, bullying habits, and the guy says, "Hey, guess what? You're not gonna be doing that anymore." And the bullies, being the lazy fools that they are, they're kind of knuckleheads. It doesn't really get through to them very easily. So this is something worth considering. It's something I hadn't thought of too much, really, in this context. Some maybe the back of my mind said, "Can't start big time in the world?" I mean, we're waiting for all these spiritual leaders of the world to start big time, but they're not big time in it. They're not big time in it. The leaders of various religions and spiritual movements and all this stuff, a lot of the gurus in the world, they're not big time in the world. They're not. I say, what are you doing? You got to step on it right now. Otherwise, this world is going to absolutely, totally crush you. It's in full crusher mode. It's in the mood. The world's in this full crusher mood and mode. And the world's expecting to bully us, spiritually bully us. The ego expects to spiritually bully us. I find this very helpful to look at this situation in this way. It's a change of perspective, isn't it? Are we really little orphans? Are we really orphans at this point? You meet Longchenpa? Are you some sort of spiritual orphan still? Or Jamyang Genti Chogyi Lodra? You're some poor little orphan in an orphanage? And I don't know. I don't think so. It's just, it doesn't seem so, does it? Not really. Yeah, the Brahmins will say, yeah, we've been saying this stuff for thousands of years, you know, there's only one, everything, you know, even this, the self, even the human self is God, you know, they can trot out all the stuff, you know. I say, well, okay, that's great, but you know, do you got game right now? How much game do you have right now? Well, now's when we need the game, you know. This contemporary situation right here, right now, are you ready for that? I mean, are you bringing it? Are you big time in the world right now? Let's you know, come on, step up, let's run up the stairs. Oh no, you know, yeah, we've been running up the stairs for thousands of years. Okay, great, let's run up. We need to run up them right now, really fast. Let's go. You ready to go? Yeah, this is something that, you know, it's. It's not a problem for us. We've been doing it for thousands of years. Okay, well, guess what? You gotta do it now. You have to have game now. Now is when we're being crashed. I mean, the world is after us right now. And so we have to have game right here, right now. So this big, huge, maybe the most powerful, secretive tech company in the world, in a lot of ways, you know, this fellow's trying to intimidate me in some ways. And I just said, look, I'm on Jamyang Genti Chogyi Lodro's team. And nobody intimidates him at all. Or anyone on his team. You know, we're on his team. He's like a manager. A manager stands up for his players. Great manager like Bruce Bochy of the Giants. Great manager. He's got his players' backs. He really knows how to stand up for his players. You don't mess with his players. And it's the same way. You know, you don't mess with someone who's on Jamyang Genti Chogyi Lodro's team. You don't mess with Jamyang's team, his players. It's his team. You don't mess with his players. So I knew, hey, look, if they want to do something electronically, take some pictures, look up license plates, you know, blah, blah, you know, intimidate, think like we're doing running a background check on you, you know, hey, guess what? He's got all electronics covered too. So nobody's going to do anything to his players electronically. He doesn't want to have them done to them. It doesn't matter what way you try to do it. You know, these bullies think they're going to bully us electronically. No, not someone on his team. He already removed a bug from my computer. Something's wrong with my computer. I ask him to fix it. He fixes it. Now, I'm not going to bug him all the time about it, but the point has been made. The point has been made that, Grasshopper just showed up. Whoa. Flat out of nowhere, flew into the light here. Holy cow. Hello, Grasshopper. Wow. Oh, it's digging the light. Grasshopper saying, where did this light come from? And it's the middle of the night. It's a big one. Hey, well, not that huge, but it's just stuck to the side of the side of the reflector around the light. Hello, grasshopper. Nice to see you. Thanks for being here. See, grasshoppers can jump, can't they? He just jumped from, I don't know where he came from. He jumped up there. Wow. Who knows where he's going to jump to next? So we're kind of, so you can see his little feet there. Wow. He's got little fingers on his feet, little pods or something. Like it's, that's really interesting. Hey, grasshopper. So this is a very interesting video, right? I didn't know it would take this kind of turn. And now my eyes are all fried from looking at the light. That's okay. So I'm just wowing the content of what we've gone through. It's very important to do that. You just realize, wow, this is really quite something that we're really expanding and this is it's important what's happening. So I was like at the airport, for instance. I was put in some intense situations today. One is at the airport, the other is this super high profile, super security, secret, tech endeavor. And both situations, I'm waiting out at the curb of the airport, and I know that the policeman security is going to come by at some point. I'm there to wait too long. But I just say, hey, Jamyang Khyentse Chokyi Lodro, and just repeated that, just repeated it, and says, he's here, he's got my back, I work for him, I'm on his team, so we'll see what happens. So security did come over and I explained what's happening. They're very nice and helpful. So, oh, okay, I'll go look for them. I said, okay, they're coming now. Everything's he came over to me and said, everything's fine. I said, thanks for your appreciate your patience with me. And it's just like his attitude was like totally mellow and towards me. So he's like saying, don't worry, I'm not going to big time you, not going to big time you. Same thing at this plant, this production facility. I told the guard, I turned my badge in, but I have to go back in. He says, oh, that's okay. In other words, he didn't big time me. So I'm noticing that these people are not big timing me anymore. They could have big timed me, right? No, I'm not trying to, big time them either, but they're not big timing me in a situation where you'd think they would. So that's a subtle change right there. I'm sure Jamyang is there subtly saying, hey, this is this is a player that works for me. So you deal with him, you're dealing with me. Together, the both of us. It's not just him now. It's both of us. So people are like, wow, okay. And and he's so kind. I don't know how they could big time him. I don't know anyone could big time him. He's so kindly, you know, really. You can't help but feel kindly towards him. When he was here in Tibet, in his life, nobody big-timed him. You know, they realized he is the big time. So nobody big-timed him. But he didn't have to, you know, he didn't act like some, you know, it's just his attitude. And he says, I know where I got this. And it's just his attitude was so mellow and so kindly. And but also so completely skilled and knowledgeable about all practices, just you know, wow, nobody could big time him. So let's help him get his team together here, right? Let's help him get his team together. So I don't worry about situations like I used to. I just said, look, he's got this. Either he's got it or he doesn't, but he's got it. I'm just going to put it in his hands. So you take care of the situation. It's up to you. It's your, you know, it's your team. You know, you play it the way you want to play it. That includes the kind of stuff that I come upon. It's his team. So that's, you know, so I'm saying, I'm turning over my quote unquote destiny to him. It's really just like, how do I want to play it? My team. But it's no longer my team, it's his team. I'm just playing on his team. So it's how he wants it. How does he want? You know, he decides who we play. You know, so we're going to go, you know, he decides what our schedule is going to be. He decides what position we're going to play and who plays what and does it. That's up to him. It's his team. So let him decide that stuff. It's not, I don't have to worry about that stuff anymore, right? So that's a great feeling. It's a great feeling. I'm trying to get more and more this way, feel that way. Okay, is it getting late? Yeah, it's getting late. All right. So this has just been extraordinary. Very helpful. Very contemporary. It's just what we needed to hear right now. Because the world is getting set to big time us, folks. I'm telling you this. Yeah, we better beat him to the punch here. We have beat him to the punch, but we're just getting used to this fact. You know, getting used to the fact. We have beat the world to the punch. And we're rolling that information out. All right, very great. Beautiful, beautiful California day today and evening. And it's just, it's just, if weather could enlighten you, we'd all be enlightened here, right? I've had nothing but perfect weather my whole life, but that didn't do the job. Unfortunately, I was a weather-holic. Drunk on the weather, really. And if the weather's not good, it's like I went through like DTs, you know, withdrawal symptoms. Wow, my life's being destroyed. But recently, California hasn't had any bad weather. So, it's like, wow. Every day is ridiculously nice. Spoiled rotten. I don't want to go anywhere else. Why should I? It's perfect here in terms of the weather. How are you going to beat this? You can't really beat it, you know? Wow. It's just awesome. I mean, it's cool. It's a summer, cool summer night. But, you know, it's just like it's almost like a crispness, but it's still kind of warm, but it's the cool, there's a cool crispness to it also. It's like, I mean, just a t-shirt here, it's midnight. Then the mornings are cool, and a little breeze, it's just wow. It's like 80 degrees, sort of. Like we're like high 70s, 80. Next week is supposed to heat up a little bit, but this is just super, mega, super mega. You almost don't want to go inside, actually. I tape outside always because I just love the ambience here. It's just it's extraordinary. Okay. We're just cooling down here. We've said what needs to be said. Who's big time and who? Indeed. All right. Very great. That's it. Let me see if I can stop.